Would you pray with me as we open up the word? Father, these words come from Psalm 2. Why do the nations rage? Peoples plot in vain. Why is there such chaos and lawlessness and disorder and destruction? And the kings of the earth, the lords, the rulers, those who are responsible for governing, they set themselves and they take counsel together against you and your anointed. But you sit on your throne and you laugh. You hold them in derision. The words that you speak to them are terrifying because you are a furious God. You say, as for me, I have set my king on Zion, my holy hill. Oh, how we call upon you to be true to these words of promise that you say here. That your king, the anointed Messiah, sits on his throne and will one day sit on his throne on the earth. Father, thank you that the Son has come to you. You said, today I've begotten you. Ask of me and I will make the nations your heritage and the ends of the earth your possession. There's a day when your Son will break them with a rod of iron and dash them in pieces like a pot of dust. But oh, may we heed the words of the psalmist. We come to you in this moment right now. We want to be wise. We want to serve you with fear. We want to rejoice with trembling. That is what we have sought to do as we've gathered together this morning and sung to you and gathered around your table and celebrated what Jesus has done in the cross. So in this moment, we kiss the Son, lest he be angry with us and we perish in the way. And may we be blessed because we take refuge in Jesus. And so we come to your word now. We pray that the Son would speak to us these words in Titus. Pray that your Spirit, Lord Jesus, that you said you would send, would help us to understand his words that he inspired so long ago through the writings of Paul. Be with us now, we pray. In Jesus' name, amen. We'll be in Titus chapter 3 this morning. You want to turn there. You look at all that's happening in the world around you. Anyone feeling a little fatigued? How about just confused? Maybe asking yourself, maybe it really is time to begin withdrawing from the world around us. I've received a number of emails this week suggesting to take a break from media, to turn off all social inputs, to turn off YouTube and email and news and Facebook and Twitter and Snapchat and all of those things. Maybe you're wondering, is it time now to withdraw altogether and go be in little Christian enclaves and communities and just, we'll create our own communities, we'll find some land and we'll live there and we'll live peacefully with one another. We're tempted to withdraw. Maybe you're just tired. A part of you wants to push back. You're tired of COVID, you're tired of Zoom meetings. You're tired of liberty is lost and wondering what's it going to be next. So you want to push. We can find ourselves making hasty comments or rash judgments or assuming the motives of people who are leading or people who are behaving certain ways in the public sphere. In Titus chapter 3, verses 1 and 2, Paul tells Titus to remind the church in Crete and remind us as well today, don't rebel and don't withdraw. Instead, remember your social duty. Do good. That's his message for us this morning. Remember your social duty. Do good. So we see in Titus 3, 1 and 2. We'll read there again. Now we're using the ESV if you want to join along. Here Paul says, remind them to be submissive to rulers and authorities, to be obedient, to be prepared for every good work, to speak evil of no one, to avoid quarreling, to be gentle, and to show perfect courtesy to all people. Paul urged Titus to establish order and health in that young church community on Crete. So Titus taught the lifestyle which accords with sound doctrine. And it's grace that buoys this lifestyle. All throughout the book of Titus we see that. God elected, God promised, God manifested, God's grace has appeared. And King Jesus gives grace to kill sin and live godly lives, to raise our standard of hope, to set us free from lawlessness, to cleanse us of sin, and to make us his very own people, and to send us forth on a mission of good works. God's redemptive grace creates a new humanity, a people transformed by the truth, the good news of Jesus' death, resurrection, and ascension to the right hand of the Father. And that new humanity is characterized by godliness. It's such godliness that supports the truth of that gospel message. It's a gospel that truly redeems, that truly changes and transforms those who receive it. That's why it's a joy to be together with one another on Sunday morning. Amen? To be amongst the people of God who are adorning the doctrine of our God and Savior. We recognize that some of our friends are not able to be with us this morning, and we missed you. But it's another thing to live in society at large, or to welcome in strangers and neighbors into our lives. But Paul did not assume that the church was going to live in isolated communities. Rather, citizens of the kingdom of God live as dual citizens and ambassadors among foreign neighbors. So how then are we to behave in society? To be, as a popular phrase in Christianity goes, to be in the world but not of the world. This morning, remember your social duty. Do good. So how do we live as dual citizens of the kingdom of God and of the kingdoms of men? Paul begins by saying, remind them to be submissive to the rulers and authorities, to be obedient. But this is not the first time that we've heard about submission in the book of Titus. We heard about it in chapter 2. We heard that wives are to be submissive to their own husbands. In chapter 2, verses 9, we heard as well that bond servants are to be submissive to their masters. The same word is used here. The same idea is described. But we also see this idea of submission back in chapter 1 in the description of elders over against the false teachers. Paul told Titus to appoint elders, to create order in the church community. And part of that was by installing men who were godly, who submitted their lives to God and followed him. And this is over against the false teachers who are described as insubordinate. So the godly men were those who were submitting their lives to God, following him, living above reproach. But the false teachers were insubordinate and disobedient. The contrast there is clear between the two. But also, elders are supposed to have children who are not insubordinate. So here we see this idea of submission all throughout Titus. A couple weeks ago, that we described submission this way as we thought about wives. We thought about bond servants. Submission is to willingly come under the leadership of another to follow and support. Is to come under the leadership of someone else who has a responsibility or duty to follow and support them. That's submission. I don't think that shocks maybe any of us this morning, nor should the idea to be obedient. I mean, since we were little children and we've been playing that game Simon Says, we understand the idea of obedience. So when Simon says, touch your nose, you touch your nose. And when Simon says, pat your head, you pat your head. And when Simon says, wave your hands, you wave your hands. I see at least one person in the room who knows how to play Simon Says, who knows how to play that game. It's not the problem of knowing that we should obey and adhere to the rules that our civil leaders put into place in effect. It's not the idea of submission that we struggle with, of what it is and what it should look like. It's a heart issue that's really the problem underneath submission and obedience. Paul describes in Titus two ways to live. One in which God has established order in the home, in the church, in the civil state. He describes that there's leaders, there's those who have responsibility to serve others, and then others come underneath to submit and follow them. This is contrasted over against a way of living that involves insubordination, and disobedience, and lawlessness. Not only this idea is difficult for us, rather I think we have questions and there are tensions that we face as we try to think about what does it look like for me to submit and to serve underneath rest of the leaders. So let's ask a number of questions and try to think about them biblically. So Aaron, are you saying that we should submit to our civil leaders even when an established authority is not the one you voted for or not the one who shares the same political perspective as you? I would say, you look at Romans 13, verses 1 and 2. You look at the book of Daniel in chapter 4. You look at the book of Daniel in chapter 2. We see here, Daniel has these words to say. He, referring to God, changes times and seasons. He removes kings and sets up kings. It's God who puts the authorities in their role. He appoints them. And so a lack of submission to our authorities is actually a lack of submission to the God who ordains and appoints them to be in that role. Okay. Well, what about submitting to authorities when they infringe on my human liberties and my rights and my freedoms? Certainly something that we might struggle with in our day. We have a constitution that recognizes, I think, rightly, that God has given us certain rights and freedoms as people made in his image. That's put into our constitutional governing document. But Peter has this to say. Chapter 2, this first letter, live as people who are free, not using your freedom as a cover-up for evil, but living as servants of God. We are to live as those who are free in Christ, serving him at all times. And it's right after he writes those words that he says, honor the emperor. I think even more as we consider, how are we to live if our rights and liberties and freedoms are being impinged upon? We need to consider this. Laying down our rights is the way of Jesus. We hear this in Philippians 2. For though he, Jesus, was in the form of God, did not count equality with God a thing to be grasped. The idea there is that Jesus is divine. And he could grasp, it was his possession, his divinity, but he didn't grasp it. He opened up his hands and he humbled himself and he became a servant. He set aside his rights to come and do good. And he calls us to follow him in that way. The danger is that while we may have the right and the want and the desire for our freedoms to be exercised, as we would say in biblical counseling, often those wants and desires become needs. And then those needs become demands. And when our demands are not met, we're willing to sin to get them. That's the danger. Okay, well, what about this tension or this question? What about an unjust or tyrannical civil leader? Let's consider the Cretans. These are people who were known for treachery and violence and sexual corruption. A people where a term was coined in the Greek culture, kretizo. You hear kretizo, it sounds like Crete, right? To describe them as liars, because that's how they were characterized and known. These were a people who were always lying. We see back in chapter 1, verse 12, Cretans are always liars, evil beasts, lazy gluttons. Saying even their own people recognize that they are animalistic. And Paul is saying to these believers on Crete, submit to them. Be obedient. What about Paul himself? He's writing as a Roman citizen, living under the Roman Empire. And he's writing at a time in which he had already been put in jail. He had been put under house arrest in Rome. He had been freed from that. He and Titus went to Crete, planted this church, and now he's giving instruction. His instruction is not to bulk, to push against your civil leaders, but to submit to them, to be subordinate to them. A time when Nero was ruling. A man who history tells was self-serving, focused on his own glory, and who would persecute the Christians. It was in the context of that persecution that Peter was writing to encourage them to endure suffering at the hand of civil leaders, which is Nero. Peter gives the same instruction, to be subordinate, to submit to them, to honor their emperor. How far? How far am I willing to endure and suffer and be subordinate? Is there a point at which that might end and I might respond differently? You're telling me to suffer even to death. Peter says this in verse 15 of chapter 4, but let none of you suffer as a murderer or a thief or an evildoer or as a meddler. Each one of those things would have been guilty under the law. And the state had the authority and responsibility to punish those people who would behave that way. Peter says, yet if anyone suffers as a Christian, that's the key right there, as a Christian, suffering for faith in Christ, for the gospel, let him not be ashamed, but let him glorify God in that name. All throughout the book of Peter, earlier, after he gives instruction about submitting to your leaders, honoring the emperor, he talks about the example and way of Christ, the suffering that he endured, and then he calls Christians to follow in the footsteps of Jesus. Now, does this mean that submission has no qualifiers? There's no unqualified times when we might disobey and not listen to the government leaders. Well, consider these biblical examples. The Hebrew midwives don't listen to Pharaoh. And they allow the baby boys to live in Egypt. Or Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego don't bow down to Nebuchadnezzar and worship him, so they're thrown into the fire. Esther chooses to go into the king's presence to speak to him about the plight of her people Israel, even though the king has ordered that that's not allowed. Daniel has some political opponents, and they decide to make this rule that says you have to bow down and worship Darius and pray to him. And Daniel goes up, and in front of the window where he can be seen by everybody, chooses to pray to God instead of Darius. But then there's the three wise men who Herod says, when you find the baby boy, this king was born, come back and tell me where he is. They don't listen, they disobey, they don't return, they go another way back to their land. And the one perhaps they were coming familiar with, Peter and John, who say, we will not obey men, but rather we will obey God. We will preach the gospel, the good news of Jesus. I think Bobby Jameson captures the idea for us here in this phrase. When the government commands what God forbids, or forbids what God commands, it gives us permission and ground to not obey, to not submit ourselves to our civil leaders. Again, when the government commands what God forbids, or forbids what God commands. Because there's an authority over these civil leaders, and that's God himself. He's the one who appoints them. And if the lower authority instructs us to disobey God, we obey God in the midst of the kingdom. I think most of the tension here has to do with who has authority over what jurisdiction. There's the family, and there's the church, and there's the state. When it seems like those jurisdictions overlap, who's responsible for saying what you can do and can't do? That's where most of the tension lies for us. We don't have time to unravel all of the examples and questions that could possibly come up with, or even all those that have come up during the season of the coronavirus and all of that. As I've thought about this text, I keep coming back to Peter and Paul's example. These were men who spent time in jail. In jail. For naming the name of Christ, for doing gospel ministry and work. But they didn't get into jail because they were breaking the law and being insubordinate citizens. And they were men who were broken out of jail by supernatural acts. So we have to wrestle with that. But what I do find challenging, attention for me, is that these men were later crucified and put to death, if history, the record tells us rightly, that the Roman Empire put them to death in the same way that Christ was murdered on the cross. And yet, Peter and Paul, when writing to God's people, don't give any qualifiers. They don't look to the Old Testament and those examples of disobedience. Rather, they say this: remind them to be submissive to rulers and authorities, to be obedient. So friends, I think the exhortation here is that we would defer to our civil leaders. We would come under them and we will submit. And I think this is all the more important because Jesus, our God, our Savior, the King who sits on the throne over all, delivers us from all lawlessness, insubordination, and disobedience. That's what we saw in Titus chapter 2. That he takes our hearts that are predispositioned to buck against authority, to be prideful. And he does away with that lawlessness. And the idea that we would be freed from lawlessness, to turn around that and demonstrate that freedom through rebellion and not submitting, just doesn't work with what the gospel does and accomplishes in God's people. I hope that we would find that this is immensely freeing, this instruction, this exhortation to defer to our leaders, to submit to them. That I don't have to be an epidemiologist. I don't have to be the governor or the president or work for the CDC. I don't have to have any of those roles that are responsible with making public policy. That doesn't mean a Christian couldn't serve in those positions. They should and they ought to. Those are not my roles. I'm not a lawyer. I'm not a judge. Instead, I can just be a husband and a father and a pastor and a counselor and a neighbor. And I'm freed up to go and do those things as I submit to my leaders. I follow their instructions that they give. Where lawlessness abounds, submission shines brightly. So friends, let's defer to our civil leaders. We're not only dual citizens, we're also ambassadors. So how then do we live as ambassadors, if you will, in a foreign land amongst foreign people? Paul says be ready to do good, especially in speech and conduct. That's our second point. It says, remind them to be ready for every good work, to speak evil of no one, to avoid quarreling, to be gentle and to show perfect courtesy toward all people. And when he says doing good, this preparedness, it's a readiness. I grew up as a Boy Scout, and our motto was always be prepared. So if you're going out camping, you have your knife on you and your water bottle and your health kit, you know, your first aid kit. You have that ready in your car. You're always ready and prepared for what life might throw at you. This preparedness is also an eagerness. You're on your tiptoes. You're ready. If the ball drops, you're ready to catch it. If you will, that the ball dropping is any opportunity to do good. That's what we're to be prepared for, to do good. I find it very interesting that in two other places where both Paul speaks in Romans 13 and Peter speaks in 1 Peter 2, when he talks about the relationship of God's people to the leaders in society, he has this to say. So here's Romans 13:3. For rulers are not a terror to good conduct, but to bad. Would you have no fear of the one who is in authority? Then do what is good, and you will receive his approval. 1 Peter 2:15, for this is the will of God, that by doing good, you should put to silence the ignorance of foolish people. In all three places in the New Testament, where we're given instruction about relating to the civil leaders and authorities, we're told to do good. Philip Towner comments on our text here and says, yet subjection also necessitates the more active expression of the Christian life, which is, according to the early church's code, traditionally termed doing good. But the later says, this was the attitude of the respectable, loyal citizen. Doing good is Christian existence portrayed in tangible ways in the life of the believer or the community collectively, as the observable manifestation of the Holy Spirit. Paul has stressed in other contexts that this expression of the Spirit will include socially responsible behavior. End quote. The new community is going to be about doing good. We see this first in a gracious speech. He says to speak evil of no one and to avoid quarreling. What does he mean to speak evil of no one? This idea that you won't malign someone, that you won't slander them, you won't revile them. It's not to bring a false charge against someone, to defame their character and reputation. In the Gospels, we see people doing this when Jesus was hanging there on the cross. Those who passed by derided him, wagging their heads and saying, you who would destroy the temple and rebuild it in 3 days, save yourself. You are the Son of God. Come down from the cross. They derided Jesus when he was hanging there. They slandered him. They spoke evil of him. 1 Peter 4 says this, the time that has passed suffices for doing what the Gentiles want to do, living in sensuality, passions, drunkenness, orgies, drinking parties, and lawless idolatry. With respect to this, they are surprised when you do not join them in the same flood of debauchery, and they malign you. They defame you and your character, and they bring false charges against you because you don't join in with them in the way that they live. Why do we find ourselves being given to speak evil of others? Peter says this in the second Peter 2 as well, blaspheming about matters of which they are ignorant. There's a reason why we speak evil and slander. Because we don't know. Because we don't have the information. We don't know the facts. And I think this is a relatively hard word for us in our culture, particularly in this moment. It's one thing when I see the world speaking evil, for instance, maligning us because we don't join in with them, or as they maligned Jesus there on the cross. But it deeply saddens me when I see Christians doing the same thing. We're a people who value Christian ethics. We've been studying that on Sunday morning. The ethical actors make a choice, and they behave, they speak, or they do something. That action is morally right or it's morally wrong. There's a result that comes about from that action. We know that out of the abundance of the heart, the mouth speaks. So it's a heart with desires that's driving those actions. We're a people who value biblical counseling as well. That there's a process and a way of knowing others, of spending time with them, of asking questions, of gathering data and information to understand what's happening and taking place. I often work with men who are struggling with sexual sin. And while we can say that that act is wrong and sinful, I often walk with them through an article that's 19 motives for sexual sin. 19. I'm sure that there are more than that. Desires of the heart that drive that behavior. It takes time to draw those out and to understand what people are wanting when they pursue different sins. We're also people who value biblical justice. Ethics, counseling, justice, all of these things leading us to be a people who value truth, Truth, it takes time to gather data, to ask questions, to find the facts, to consider behavior as evidence. And most of all, to refrain from assuming that we know the heart's desire and the motives that are driving people. So let's not be a people who speak evil, who slander. When we look at what's happening with the coronavirus, and we assume what's inside of other people's hearts, with the reactions and responses that they have to the virus, we make claims about what's happening, what's motivating them to respond to the news of this virus, what they're being told by their leaders for how to live. Let's not be a people when an awful, horrific act is committed by a police officer who's meant to save and protect and care for the lives of those he serves, does an unjust thing of putting his knee on the neck of another human being. No doubt that we can look at that act and say that it was horrific, unjust, wrong. Let's not be a people who jump to the assumption that we know the narrative of what's happening. That we know for sure that this man was driven by racism. That a white man killed a black man because he was a racist. I see that being claimed all over the place right now by the world and by Christians. We just don't know that. Maybe that's what motivated him when he did that. But we don't know, and only the process of justice is going to bring that out. How much do we do this with our neighbors? When we look at the things that they do. The ways that they take care of their yard or don't take care of their yard, the things that they do with their vehicles, the way they live in their houses, and how they interact with their kids and their spouses. We can look at the behaviors. We can make judgments about right and wrong. We need to be careful not to judge their hearts and their motives. We shouldn't speak evil of anyone. We also want to avoid quarreling. This is another qualification of 1 Timothy 3. There, we refer to it as being peaceable. So we're ready to be peacemakers. But why do we find ourselves struggling, getting into quarrels? Well, James here is so helpful. What causes quarrels and fight? What causes fights amongst you? Is it not this that your passions are at war within you? You desire and do not have, so you murder. You covet and cannot attain, so you fight and quarrel. So, what good news is it that grace has appeared? Grace that trains us to renounce worldly passions, to put them to death, to say, no more will I be ruled by my passions. That's good news, that Christ has come and he gives us grace to not live this way. But then this exhortation, to speak evil of no one, to avoid quarreling, is possible because grace has appeared. So, this past season, as we find ourselves considering what our leaders have been saying and doing, we find ourselves tempted in our speech to complain, and mock, or slander, or sow discord. Be quick to speak evil of those who are ruling and leading. To get into quarrels and fights with others. Paul speaks here against two forms of speech. He also speaks to us about our conduct. Conduct that is gentle. He encourages us to be gentle. To always show perfect courtesy toward all people. Now, I love the idea of gentleness that we see over in Philippians 4. You have Euodia and Syntyche, who are fighting with one another. And Paul is encouraging the church of Philippi to come in and mediate and help these two sisters work things out. And one of the things he says to them is, let your reasonableness, which is also the same word here, let your gentleness be known to everyone. Be forbearing. Be patient with one another. Be slow to speak. Reason with each other. Work through things. Gentleness is another elder qualification over in 1 Timothy 3. And I think Paul's helpful because he says it's not violent, but gentle. The elders are the type of men who are not going to be quick to be violent and to jump into the ring and take up hands and to fight. They're not a people who are going to use force to bully and lead others to follow them and to follow God. This is the picture we have of what it means to be gentle and what it not means not to be gentle. Showing perfect courtesy toward all people. This is a bucket that's overflowing at all times, ready to be humble and considerate of others, to be meek, to show courtesy. It's towards all people, whether poor or rich, the same skin color or a different skin color, different ethnicity or culture, different economic status, different political persuasion, different belief than you, a different maybe understanding even of what the text of Scripture is saying, different Christian perspective. All peoples, all types of peoples in all different roles are deserving of our courtesy and kindness. Paul Tocke, a pastor and biblical counselor, has these words to say about this idea of gentle conduct. Gentleness is the Christ-like quality in meekness, which flows from the strength of humility, especially when under affliction. This is the humble king who rides on a donkey into the capital city. Not on a war horse, not in a chariot, not with a pompous parade of strength and force behind him. King Jesus coming into his city, a donkey, humble and low. Hebrews 5 is talking about Jesus as high priest and has these words to say. He can deal gently with the ignorant and wayward, since he himself is beset with weakness. And Dana Orton, in his book, Gentle and Lowly, has these words to comment on that verse. It says, the idea here in 5:2 is that Jesus does not throw his hands up in the air when he engages sinners. He's calm, tender, soothing, restrained. He deals with us gently. Is that how the king has dealt with you in your sin? Is that how he's wooed you and drawn you to himself by offering grace and his gentleness rather than harshness and condemnation? This is Jesus who says, come to me, all who labor and weary, all who labor and are heavy laden, and I will give you rest. Take my yoke upon me and learn from me. Why? Jesus reveals his heart, for I am gentle and lowly. For I am gentle and lowly in heart, and you will find rest for your souls. For my yoke is easy and my burden is light. Called to be gentle because this is the way of the King. And his grace has purchased the ability for us to live this way as well. Now, some of you might be asking, does that mean if I'm to speak evil of no one, I'm to avoid quarrels and fighting, I'm to be gentle, does that mean that I can never confront sin, I can never confront error, I can never disagree with someone? But clearly, Paul himself, in the letter to Titus, chapter 1, confronts the sin and error of false teachers. In a couple of weeks, we'll take up Paul's instructions to Titus for how to deal with divisions in the body. So this instruction to be gentle with others isn't a reason for us to not deal and confront with sin or error. Gentleness ought to qualify how we do that. Let's take a step back and consider these words come in the context of that first submission to defer to our leaders, to submit to them, right? So gentleness should qualify how then we might engage in interacting with our leaders. So if your response when your leaders instruct you to live a certain way is to buck against that, to push against it. I think that that's a reason for us to check our hearts. Rather, we should be forbearing and gentle with them. We should be patient to listen and understand what they're asking us to do. Let's consider one example, and then we'll wrap up here. So if the state tells us not to sing, for instance, or not to celebrate the Lord's Supper, because in a season of coronavirus, that influences the spread of the virus that they are concerned about, and putting people at risk, we would say, with all respect, after considering and understanding what they would be asking us to do, we'd have to say, God tells his people to sing when they gather. Within Colossians and Ephesians, he gives that instruction. When you gather, sing psalms, hymns, and spiritual songs. But could gentleness qualify how we would not listen to and obey leaders who would ask us not to sing? Now, in Minnesota, they didn't put it that strongly. They didn't tell us that we couldn't sing, but they more or less suggested that we ought not to sing. But what if gentleness, not speaking evil, and avoiding a fight looks like the way we interact with them? At the end of the day, we said, we understand the spirit of what your concern is, that you don't want a virus to spread. That's what you're concerned about. But we have to sing. We must sing when we gather together as God's people. So here's how we're going to try to do this. Just thought exercise for us to think through how we would work this out. We're not going to have a choir. We don't normally have a choir up here. We wouldn't have a choir of people singing in close proximity to each other. It's part of why we just have one singer up here. Maybe more than 6 feet of distance is needed if we're going to sing. They really push. We need to expand that out so that there's more space between us when we sing. Maybe we'd be willing to wear a mask so that we can reduce the air droplets as they spread, because singing is supposed to send them further. And maybe, I like this one, I thought about it. Maybe we just go outside and we sing, because there's more space. And that would mean that we're together as God's people singing in front of the community, and they're hearing us worship God as we gather together.
Yeah.
Could an instruction like this in our response actually lead to a chance to witness to our God, to our community? And our friend Joe's not with us, but certainly this would mean that we're not going to be engaged in operatic style music, really belting it out when we sing. Maybe we choose to sing at the end of our service. The end, so that we sing one or two songs, and it's at the end, the droplets aren't spreading around the room, and having more time to circulate. So all sorts of ways that we try to work out what the text is giving us here. We are people who engage in gentle speech and conduct as we interact with our leaders, as we seek to live out and submit to you. Remember this, where lawlessness abounds, gentleness shines bright. So deal gently with your neighbors, friends. Deal gently with them. I hope that our time in Titus 2 this morning has been a refresher, a reminder for us. I think there are things that are novel and new to us. We're just rethinking through them and what they would mean for us, in terms of our social duty to those who are around us. So remember your social duty. Do good. Defer to your civil leaders. And deal gently with your neighbors. Now, living this way is not always easy. And there are tensions that we're all wrestling with. In part, next week, God our uncle is going to help us as we step into the next section in chapter 3, verses 3 to 8. A section that motivates us, especially in such trying times that we find ourselves in right now. A text that puts some wind in our sails as we seek to live this out by motivating us to see what God has done in the gospel as we seek to be those who do good to our leaders and neighbors. Until then, let's scatter as dual citizens, ambassadors to our neighbors, to do good to those around us. We pray. Father, we bow our knee to you in spirit. Lord Jesus Christ, we bow our knee to you. We kiss you, the Son. You are King. You reign. O God, because you are king and you order the world, even a broken world, we ask you for help to submit our lives to the leaders that you have placed over us. We ask that we may live a peaceful and quiet life, godly and dignified in every way. May this be good and pleasing in your sight. Father, you desire that all types of people would be saved, would come to the knowledge of the truth. So please help us to be ready to do good to all people. Train us to be a gentle people, treating every one of our neighbors with courtesy. And may our way of life that demonstrates the gospel, that we are a redeemed people, may that also create opportunities to communicate the gospel of grace to those we live with and walk with and love in our communities this week, we pray. In Jesus' name, amen.